Human resource management on BCTV is supported by Mosteller and Associates.
Good evening. My name is Bob Orzechowski, the producer and host for Human Resource Management. We're coming to you tonight live on Tuesday, July 10th at 6 p.m. from the campus of Albright College at 13th and Richmond Streets. We invite home viewers tonight, 610-378-0426, for you home viewers with questions, comments, and gentle complaints. The program tonight is Employee and Labor Relations. This is our 80th program, our 13th year, and to start, we'd certainly like to thank our underwriter, Chet Mosteller, and the fine people at Mosteller & Associates. They're a full-service professional human resource consulting firm, and you can see their contact information here and also at the bottom of the program, but you can reach them at 610-779-3870. They're at 2433 Morgantown Road, which most people local know about it as Route 10, and you can see their contact information. They are a full-service professional HR consulting firm. For all of you out there who can't get to this kind of work in your own companies or for being too small to have your own professional HR person, give Chet a call and see if there can be some help provided. The program tonight, as I said, Employee and Labor Relations. It's a lot of information to talk about. We want to get to it close here, but we want a disclaimer first. Nothing here is meant to be legal advice. And the opinions of the panelists are their own and not necessarily those of their employers or of BCTV. Speaking of BCTV, we want to emphasize to you what a local resource they are for all of us. If you've ever gotten onto their website, bctv.org, there's a tremendous variety of programming. You can get notices and emails from them simply by sharing your email address with them. The goal, pretty simple. Enhance the unity and strength of our community by providing this medium for the exchange of ideas and programming. If you've ever seen the BCTV website and looked at the listing of programs, it is incredible. There's something there for everybody, and no matter what shift you're working, these shows are all replayed. And speaking of replays, this program, Human Resource Management. It's replayed Fridays at 8 p.m., Saturdays at 1 p.m., and Wednesdays at 9 a.m. So no matter when you're working, when you're traveling, making dinner, whatever it is, you can catch all their programming. We also want to mention to you that we are online streaming at bctv.org, and yes, you can catch us worldwide because of that technology, huh? Well, we're also members of the Society of Human Resource Management, a professional HR firm, organization that is, 501c6. And it's based in Washington, D.C., Alexandria to be precise. It's got about 300,000 members in over 100 countries around the world, but their headquarters is just down the road in Washington. Berks County Chapter 179, of which we are also members, is an affiliate of that organization. And I'd like to turn it over to our panelists here, who I'll introduce in a moment, to talk about their experiences with Sherman, with Chapter 179. To my immediate left is Jennie Rodriguez-Priest. She's the Executive Director of Human Resources. And Kathy Dale, to my far left, is the Human Resources Manager at local companies. So I'd like to turn it over to them and ask them to share a little bit about the chapter, what they do, why they belong, and we'll give a little plug for that. And maybe if you're interested, you'll give us a call. Our contact information will be at the bottom of the program. Jennie?
Thank you, Bob. Good evening. I have been a member of the Society for Human Resources Management nationally for a number of years. And locally, I just joined our chapter recently because it's very important in my profession, or in our profession rather, to be able to network with other professionals and share ideas and resources that we can use in our respective companies that we work for. So I find the interactions and the seminars extremely invaluable. Kathy?
Thank you, and thank you for having me. I've been in HR for 20 years. I was part of the Berks, actually the national SHRM for those years. And then when I moved up to this area 10 years ago, I did join the Berks County SHRM. Great resource for education, networking. They have lunch webinars, lunch meetings for, you know, to share and network with the information. And also, too, I use SHRM as a resource. I actually got involved in a study group, which helped me pass my certification, my HR certification. So a lot of great resources, definitely worthwhile to join.
Thank you both. The chapter, we do provide a study group. The society, the national organization, does provide a professional certification, which is a very rigorous course of study over several months. There is a 3.5-hour exam, I believe it's that long now, that has about a 60% pass rate. So it is quite rigorous, and we provide that. We provide a holiday dinner for the children down at the Police Athletic League Olivet Boys and Girls Clubs. I believe they've combined, and that's their name now. We also have a diversity and inclusion committee, which is very active, and we've recently partnered with the Berks Workforce Investment Board in that area. We also collaborate with the local Chamber of Commerce and Industry and a lot of their HR initiatives. So if you're interested, you don't have to have HR in your title to be a member. You do have to have some relevance to the profession, of course, but we've got people in the consulting industry. We have search firms. We have people who actually are practicing HR people in different companies. We have business owners who themselves have HR responsibilities, but aren't big enough to have their own HR individual yet. So it is a community resource, it's a national resource, and we encourage you to take part in that. Moving on to our topic for tonight, employee and labor relations. We were talking about this earlier, most of our focus tonight is going to be in the private sector. There are public sector organized employees and public sector non-union employees. The same in the private sector. There are some significant differences, though, so we'd like to talk about mostly HR's role in dealing in those private sector companies and where HR fits into their activities. But there was a recent Supreme Court decision about right-to-work laws and paying dues that impacts mostly the public sector unionized employees. And I'd like to turn it over to Jennie and Kathy here for a moment for their take on the Supreme Court decision, what it means, who it's impacting, and then we can move on to the private sector for the rest of the program. I would like to remind everyone out there in video land and viewing land, 610-378-0426. We are live tonight and we welcome your call-in, home viewers. Jennie, what about the Supreme Court decision?
Well, Bob, in the case of Janice versus AFSCME, the court ruled in a 5-4 vote with the conservatives winning out that government employee unions cannot require represented workers to pay dues or fees anymore. And the plaintiff in this case, Mr. Janice, brought forth the claim because the AFSCME union he belonged to had a collective bargaining agreement that as a condition of continued employment, he was required to join the union. He was required to pay dues. He was required to pay fees to a private organization that he did not necessarily want to be part of.
Excuse me, he had to be a member of the union to work there?
Yes. And many contracts or collective bargaining agreements, as they are known in the labor relations world, have that language that says an employee upon hire or perhaps after a probationary period is required to join the union as a condition of employment and could subsequently be terminated if the employee decides to stop paying union dues, among other issues. So the decision itself is going to have profound impact on labor unions regarding the revenue that they could generate in the future. Did you want to add anything to that, Kathy?
I'm just curious and eager to see how this will affect the private sector, because I know many private sectors, that is the terms of the contract. I've worked with previous contracts, a current contract, and that is a criteria that within so many days, within 90 days, you have to become part of the union and start paying dues. So it'll be interesting to see where this goes.
Well, if you look way back in a little bit of a history lesson, the very first unions in America actually were charged in Massachusetts under conspiracy doctrine, that to organize labor into a collective and approach an employer for whatever terms or demands were going to be articulated, the Massachusetts courts labeled that conspiracy. So we can see that the wheel of justice has turned full circle on that one. And there have been laws out there, 1914, and main one in 1935, 32, establishing the rights of employees to organize, in fact. And in 1935, the National Labor Relations Act established the National Labor Relations Board, among many other things. And some people don't realize that the National Labor Relations Act covers all employees, not just unionized employees, and therefore, and we're going to talk about that tonight with policies and handbooks and what our Section 7 rights. So with the concepts, though, employee and labor relations, and just in the private sector, Kathy, could you talk about the differences in those two concepts, employee relations and labor relations? Are they the same thing?
In my experience, especially with my company, we try to treat all employees the same, fairly. So with the labor relations, there's a contract, a bargaining agreement with a set of work rules, whatnot, and then you know, you have your, on the employee side, on the non-union side, you try to keep everything even-keeled. There are a lot of nuances, a lot of differences, but at the end of the day, you know, you're treating your employees fairly and following the process. Okay.
Well, I see we have a home viewer. Thank you, Kathy. Yes, may we have your first name, please?
Yes, this is Christian.
Yes, sir. What can we do for you?
Well, I'm watching your program, and I wanted to comment on the Janus decision, the recent U.S. Supreme Court case. I think it's going to be very interesting in both the public and private sector to see how unions respond. On one side of the equation, the impact immediate is more significant on the public sector because literally, effective immediately, fair share employees are no longer having that deducted from their paychecks. So they effectively received an increase. But long term, it remains to be seen, and I would welcome some comments, what the unions actually do. They may, and several have spent quite a bit of time fighting back against the decision, but I think they would do better if they focused on what their members want for the dues they pay. Because if I'm a member, and I'm not, but if I was a member, I would be asking the question, okay, what am I really getting for the dues that I'm paying? And if I now have the option to not be a member and not have to pay what is known as fair share, I may step away. And I know in some states, where this option has been put on the table, unions have seen 30 to 40% of their membership over time go away. I'd be curious to hear what your thoughts are, and I know you're focused on the private sector, but I think it's going to impact both The immediate impact is more so on the public sector. I'll hang up and listen to your response.
Well, thank you very much, sir. And you make an excellent point about it impacting both sectors. I suppose the if I understand it right, Jennie, that they don't have to pay the union dues to be a member of the union, but the union can still assess them a fee to cover the cost of collective bargaining.
That's correct.
And so therefore they're still out of pocket, but to the caller's point, now that leads the members to consider a value equation. If that agency fee is $5 a day, I'm just throwing out a number, if it's $5 a day, and that's the cost of collective bargaining, paying the steward, defending in discipline and all those things, how do we monetize the value of whatever the agency fee is? If it mirrors the union dues, who knows? But there's a value equation now that the caller made, which we want to delve into a little bit. And I'm concerned about HR's responsibility of keeping what Kathy referred to as an even keel when you're going to have some staunch union supporters calling the people freeloaders or calling them names because now they don't pay dues. And so we as HR people, this is creating issues for us. Just implementing this, new forms to opt in instead of opt out, payroll concepts. So what do you make of this?
Well, to follow up on Christian's comment, I actually have one union out of five with whom I work with where the employees have the option to join the union after the probation period has expired. It's the only one that we have. And the reason is because the skill set for this particular group of people is so high in demand that they know that they stand a better chance of negotiating their own salaries and putting themselves in a position where they are more marketable rather than paying the dues to the union and hopefully getting incremental increases to the extent we can negotiate them in the future.
Okay, Kathy, what do you think about that?
That's an interesting concept. I'd like to see too how it would affect benefits. I know my company, they're very pro-union, not because of what the union offers, but they state the benefits are wonderful. They have a very rich benefit plan that they can take advantage of being part of a large group of insured, under a self-insured plan. So, okay, you know, making these decisions, you know, and giving them the option also opens up, you know, that Pandora's box of, okay, now what happens to the benefits they have access to? Does that cut that off? The pension or any other benefits like that? How does it affect that?
Well,
that would be an option.
I think we can't lose sight of the fact, too, just like with the Fair Labor Standards Act, there was a reason in 1938 that law was needed.
Right.
I mean, there was no child labor law, there was no overtime law, there was no record keeping, and face it, employers abused employees. And today, that's become probably one of the most violated laws in business. It's just so hard to keep track with. And I think if you look at years ago, I mean, the labor movement in the United States is colorful, to say the least. And yeah, it's had its turbulent periods, but I don't think you'd have the safety records in the mines and some of the higher wages and benefits packages over non-union people. But over the years, technology, demographics, and actually so many federal and state laws prohibiting many of the things that unions contracted to keep out of the workforce have imposed themselves on the union, on the workers, all workers. So it's not to suggest that they're irrelevant now, but so many of the reasons for unions are overshadowed, shall we say, by ERISA and OSHA and all these other laws. So we turn ourselves then, and I'm interested, Kathy, to hear how both of you actually deal with this. You have a workforce that's partly non-union by choice, and you have a workforce that's partly union by choice. Do you have two separate HR people, two separate HR departments, two separate, how do you deal with that? In all the things that HR has to deal with, does it start with policy manuals, or do you try to mirror things the best you can? How do you do that?
In my company, we mirror the best we can. We have an HR team, it's myself and HR coordinator, and we handle both union and non-union. So again, keeping things on even keel, we have many of the policies that just mirror each other. In fact, some of the policies are numbered differently to be included in the union packet and numbered differently, you know, different number for the non-union packet. So we try to, you know, put out there that we expect the same of all our employees. We're here together, and whether you're union or non-union, we're here to work together. So.
And it would seem to me, I heard one union representative years ago articulate that we never want to strike. We always want to find a way to keep people working.
Yes.
Because then, you know, nobody wins in a strike situation if things get that contentious.
Exactly.
I kind of believe that. You know, you have to believe that. But with today's low unemployment, especially in this area, we heard today at our monthly meeting how difficult it is to find anybody. But Jennie, now is that your situation there, where things are trying to be kept identical, if that's the right word?
Yes, that's true. I have a very small team of HR professionals who work with me. I am the principal person who works with the unions with respect to negotiations because of my experience and my legal background. But in our role, we have to strike a very delicate balance between managing the goals of the business while also simultaneously helping employees with contractual, emotional, physical, and practical relationship, everything that's in the employee relations bucket. Mm-hmm. And so everything in the employee relations bucket is applicable whether you're a union or a non-union employee. Union employees know that they can come to our office for advice and counsel, and they know when they need to go to their shop steward if they have a question regarding the CBA or something related to their work schedule.
CBA, for the audience,
is the collective bargaining agreement that governs the relationship between the company and the local union who represents the members.
Okay. Something that might be common in both entities is alternative dispute resolution tools. What kind of tools do you both have in your armamentarium? Because the workplace is going to have some conflicts sometimes, disagreements. And is that one area that HR really has to work at? And what kind of ADRs do you have going in your firms that you see work?
In our company, we don't have a formal ADR process. But if an employee is subject to discipline, in accordance with our company policy, he or she has 10 days to submit a rebuttal. And if there is strong, if they present a strong case that they shouldn't have been disciplined, there was a mistake, there was a miscommunication, then we certainly will give them the opportunity to defend their position. If not, then the disciplinary warning will stand and their rebuttal becomes part of their personnel file.
Okay.
Sounds like the same process we have. You know, we start first too with, especially if it's a major discipline, doing research first and investigation process that we would do for either side. And then, you know, the discipline would be initiated. And then again, 10 days to, they can file a grievance. And then they have a chance to present their side and go from there, either reversed or it stands.
So HR has the tools in place to provide for due process.
Correct.
Because we want that as citizens in a republic. We want that level of industrial jurisprudence, if you will. And so it's not a bread and butter issue necessarily. But speaking of that, for the companies out there that maybe do not have any collective bargaining agreements in place now, non-union or union-free, whatever terms you want to use, what kind of things does HR need to do to mitigate the opportunity for unions to come in the first place? People sometimes think that low wages are why employees unionize. I'm not so sure. The research points that out. What is your experience with that?
My experience personally is open door policy. Keeping your door open that employees feel comfortable coming to you with any concerns, training your managers to have an open door policy, train them on how to be good listeners, and work through problems. Also, too, you do need to be competitive. So, if you want to be competitive wage-wise, continuously do your research and update your studies on wages in the area and make adjustments if necessary. So things like that, basically treating employees civilly and making them feel, let them know that you are valued and you're an important part of the process, you're an important part of the team, and making them feel connected, involved.
Mm-hmm. In my experience, I've actually undergone 3 or 4 union organizing campaigns in various industries in several states. And in every single one, I can't emphasize enough the fact of communication and knowing your employees. And when we looked at why they were organizing, some of these companies we had were acquired companies, they didn't have a handbook. A simple handbook that explains what the management rights are, what explains what the expectations of employees are. The wage structure, as Kathy mentioned, you need to be able to be in a position to communicate to them what the structure is, why this wage structure is, how people can earn additional income to help and grow and develop them. Open door policy can work in certain situations. It depends on what hierarchical structure your organization has, but employees need to be able to understand and embrace the fact that they have a voice. And they have someone to go to. And as HR professionals, we need to be their advocates. A union employee has every right to voice his opinion just as strongly as a non-union employee in the same environment. And the one thing that I have found is very successful is to treat people with dignity and respect.
And as we all want to certainly do that, the research I was able to locate as far as reasons for unionizing, at this point, we won't talk about decertifications or anything, but for unionizing is employees need to be felt cared for, they looked out for, they want to be in on things. And the era of the dictatorial management, the dictatorial boss, is a sure step in the direction of seeing the authorization cards come out. Mm-hmm. And then second, I think, is safety. And only third do we get into bread and butter issues, which, I mean, that's Maslow's hierarchy of needs when you think
right.
about it. So we mentioned in all this communication, there was a flurry of activity from the National Labor Relations Board a couple of years ago about Section 7 rights. That all employees, regardless if they're union or not, are legally allowed to engage in protected, concerted activity, whatever that means. And the NLRB at that point was going a little bit far afield as opposed to with social media, confidentiality, workplace conduct. I'd like you both, if you could, to comment on what's in your policies or procedures or whatever, what's your tolerance level? How do you strike that balance between the needs to run the business, keep confidentiality, control workplace conduct, and at the same time recognize Section 7 rights that all employees have, regardless if they're a union or not?
In our company, in our handbook, we specifically cite the language that employees have a right to speak about terms and conditions of employment. does not bar them. And then with respect to Section 7 rights in particular, we encourage, again, we just encourage them to find a forum where they can speak freely about any terms and conditions of employment that they're not comfortable with. If we don't know, we can't help them. So essentially, that's the position that we've taken. In the handbook is communicated to all employees. When we have updates, we communicate the updates, and all employees acknowledge receipt of the handbook as well.
Okay.
We do not have a formal policy in place, but it's something we do during new hire orientation. That's the message we send out there about open communication and, you know, come in at any time, you know, if we're available and speak, you know, speak whatever's on your mind and see if we can solve it.
Does everybody get a copy of an employee handbook? Is it a condensed version of the entire policy manual? Is it all online?
No.
I mean, we make it available to employees. It's always online. Possession is our concern, not access. They have 24/7 access to it. But because it changes so much, what do you do if you have to update a page? You have to kill a tree.
Yes.
You do. You do. We our policy actually says at the bottom, uncontrolled document when printed. Because we once it's printed, we have no control. Somebody can amend it. We in our industry, we embrace social media change. So we have to make the policy available in an electronic format. Although we do have some employees who prefer the hard copy, and they get it. And you know, going back to the NLRB ruling, when they were being a little bit draconian about policy language, for example, I remember when they were trying to sanction policies that prohibited employees' use of internet, the company resources. The reality is, in the world that we live in today, it is an unreasonable expectation for an employer not to think that an employee is going to take their lunch break and go online and do some banking or go shopping on Amazon. It's an unreasonable expectation. So your policy should have wiggle room language, flexibility to be able to understand the practical business need that you have. While also understanding that this may be the only time the employee can actually take care of some personal business on their own time. And that's not unreasonable.
Okay.
Same thing with the policies. They are difficult to manage. I know for the office side, the non-union side, they all have company emails. So changes are emailed, and we also have an intranet site that we post all our policies on. Mm-hmm. With the union folks, it's a bit harder, more difficult because of the fact that most of them do not have company emails, and you're not comfortable sharing your personal emails so that we can get that information to them. So as you said, killing a tree, definitely always killing a tree. And then something's updated, we actually have our supervisors sign a list. There's a list of names for their department shift. And then as each employee is handed them the new policy or updated policy signature, employee has to sign that, and that's kept on file.
And then I imagine every employee in the union gets a copy of the union contract.
They're supposed to.
Okay.
That's not our obligation. That is the obligation of the union to ensure that they provide them with copies of the contract and that they understand it. I am a firm believer in education. I've had many union employees come to me and say, Jennie, I don't understand this paragraph in the contract. And it's disappointing that their shop steward or business agent didn't take the time to educate them, but I will, and I'll explain to them what it means to them and how it impacts their
job. And that's part of the agency fee for the people who choose not to join the union, is that they're paying for the shop steward and the business agent to, in fact, do that teaching.
Correct.
Aha, now that I understand Christian's comment. Aha, a little bit better. Gee, why are we paying this agency fee if you're not giving me what it's a value equation. That's
sure.
What it comes down to, certainly. We are live tonight, Tuesday, July 10th, 610-378-0426. We're discussing employee and labor relations, primarily in the private sector, but we are drifting back and forth across that gray line into the public sector as well. One of the things that we don't It's kind of a sort of Damocles, in a way, hanging over unionized companies. And since you both work in companies with both sets of workers, talk a little bit about unfair labor practices. Is this a minefield, or how do you deal with unfair labor practices? Or how do you define them? Or I guess training managers is probably your best tool. But why don't you talk about that for a bit?
When I train my managers, department managers who oversee union departments, the first thing I tell them is, you must understand the collective bargaining agreement. You have to read that. That is your Bible, if you will. So because when we go to negotiations, for example, the standard under the standard is one of the seven sins, I think, is failure to bargain in good faith. Mm-hmm. Okay. So unions can say, our contract expires on June 30th, and you're not even going to meet with me on June 30th. Are you trying to bargain in good faith? Well, I mean, it could be an exaggeration, but the law is designed to protect the union employees, and so it's our job to make sure that we don't run afoul of that law, and we know what we can and we cannot do in accordance with the NLRB. Unfair labor practices could also mean, let's say, a union submits an information request. An information request meaning that they would like a list of all the union employees that were hired in the last 2 years with all the demographic information, and you fail to produce it. Well, that could result in an unfair labor practice charge because they have a right to that information. It all depends on what the contract provides mm-hmm. them with.
Okay.
I agree. It does. You have to know the contract in and out. I tell supervisors all the time, if you're not sure, come to HR. Also, another thing, too, if you're unsure about a union request, contact your labor attorney. Hopefully, if you do have a union, you have a labor attorney that is experienced with union labor and labor relations. So if you have a question, you know, if not providing this information, you know, is it providing too much information? Am I violating any privacy laws by providing up to a certain amount of information? Always, consult with your company labor attorney.
We've settled a couple times now on the importance, not of HR, but of the employees, managers, and supervisors in keeping this even keel that we seek. What about managerial training? Today we're going to talk about non-union employee, how to remain union-free, but tomorrow we're going to go over chapter and verse the contents of the collective bargaining agreement for the unionized employees. Mm-hmm. I mean, is it that cut and dry, or how does this happen? Because we're agreeing that managers and supervisors better darn well be well-trained.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So how are you dealing with that?
It takes a lot. It is a ball of yarn, so to speak, very tangled sometimes. But I think at the end of the day, you have to use common sense. You know, what is thinking about what's best for the employee, what's the best for the practice, of, you know, for business reasons, and then, you know, use that contract or whatever. I think at the end of the day, using the contract gives you that guideline you need for dealing with the union folks, but just at the end of the day, treating everybody like human beings and just using common sense when it comes to making decisions.
Yeah, we seem to lose that sometimes, I think, in a lot of spheres of activity. Jennie, how do you handle that?
In our area, I'm fortunate to work in an environment where, for the most part, I have very good business relationships with our unions. Very little issues that would result in a grievance. And when I educate the management team, actually I did a training session last year that took 5 months to complete because we just... It's a lot of information. You think about it. The Department of Labor administers and enforces more than 180 federal laws alone. So to me, it's better to educate the managers on what are those federal laws that are already in effect that protect employees regardless of whether they're union members, such as the Fair Labor Standards Act that governs overtime pay, and the Age and Discrimination Act, and disability, and protections for military personnel who are coming back to reemployment. Those federal laws were enacted for this express purpose to protect their rights. And we need, as an organization, we need to understand how we can do a better job in not just complying with it, but understanding and embracing it, because it's part of our business and it's part of how our it represents our workforce.
You know, I guess when all this was happening with the NLRB and making decisions about how employers had to act for these Section 7 rights, they kind of came out with three areas. On one area, the whole comment about civility and actually coming down on employers who were insisting on respectful treatment of everyone. And when we used the word civility here mm-hmm. before, that's what prompted me to think about that. But then on the other side, it's clearly there are areas of unlawful employee behavior. Mm-hmm. But it's the large gray area that seems to give HR the most challenge. What do you think some of your greatest challenges are, and how could you suggest to the listening or the viewing people who are maybe business owners in similar situations, how do they deal with that gray area? Everybody knows what incivility is. Everybody knows what mm-hmm. harassment and intimidation is. But what about that gray area? What are you doing every day, and what do you find works and doesn't work that you can share with people out there?
I think for me, the gray area is always performance management. And so what I did for our management team is I helped them develop a template that we can actually use for improving performance management for both union employees and non-union employees. You're always going to have an issue. No one performs at 100% every single year consistently. And so when you have those problems where you really need to address a performance issue that could possibly end up with the person earning his or her way out the door in an involuntary separation, then it's important to not only for the employee to understand what the expectations are, but to understand what improvements have to be maintained and sustained. And because that's where you first start managing the relationship with trying to help the employee, but also minimizing the risk to the organization.
Hard on performance, soft on people kind of a mm-hmm. approach.
Yes.
Kathy, how about you?
I agree that performance is one of the biggest gray areas, and it's just all about persistence and progression, showing the progression of, you know, started at this point, trying to make the employee aware of the issue. And this goes for both union and non-union. So, I mean, even absence of a CBA, you know, you're still going to need, you know.
Well, now, maybe this is one of the areas where people conventionally might think there is a difference with the non-union employees. Management can come up with, and HR comes up with, performance appraisal tools, performance appraisal forms, formats, policies, procedures, all pretty much with the intent of improving performance. They're not used as clubs or as gotcha weapons. Mm-hmm. They're hopefully not used to determine pay increases. But how do you deal with performance? Do you get the union to agree on the use of a performance appraisal tool? And if so, does the union get input into it from the manager? I mean, how do you deal with performance management in an organized workforce? If it's not in the contract, that seems to be a real challenge.
We are lucky at my current company. We actually there is a process in place for the first 90 days or so. Actually, it's the first 60 days. And if their performance isn't up to speed with proper documentation, the company actually has a right to put their union status on hold and extend the probationary period another 30 days. So that helps us on that end.
And documentation's done by?
The manager. Manager, supervisor, has to have concrete areas for improvement and where they're lacking.
So we're right back to good managerial training.
Mm-hmm. And then now during the course, after they become part of the union, we're fortunate that in our work rules, we have things in place regarding performance, such as errors, and other
safety
things,
violations.
Safety violations. There's other pieces in there that shows the progressive discipline. So that is how we manage the performance on the union side.
Jennie, how about you with performance on the union side?
It's the same. We don't treat them any differently. But I would want to add that it's a risk, especially for a small employer, to manage his or her business around a collective bargaining agreement. The number one tenet in employer rights is that the employer retains the sole right to manage his or her business, to make all decisions in connection with the operation. The CBA should be a business partnership sidebar document that speaks to other terms and conditions.
So is there anything generally in a CBA that addresses the use of performance appraisal tools or forms or processes, not only to ensure due process, but to ensure quality work?
Not at the company that I work at, and not in any of the CBAs that we have. They leave the performance management to the discretion of the company. So that's why I ensured that if we're ever challenged, the form, the template that is used for union employees is the same form that's used for non-union employees.
How about productivity issues? I mean, we heard sometimes in certain union environments, maybe in a more industrial area, that if there are disagreements, suddenly the union decides to work safe, which basically means
right.
slow down.
Like
so how does, and I'm not saying that that's what happens. I'm saying, how do we address the issue of productivity with a non-union workforce? It might be more straightforward. In a unionized workforce, how do you handle productivity? How do you articulate it, manifest that in the CBA?
I don't believe it is addressed in the CBA. In any of the
because
CBAs
it's a business
that I have.
Arrangement.
Because it's a business arrangement.
Right.
And
excellent
if
point.
And if there's a if an employee intentionally slows down production, we would certainly know about it. We have other metrics available.
Or create more errors or more waste or scrap or whatever.
Correct. Okay. And so then it essentially would become a performance issue.
Great. Kat?
With our work rules, and there is wording in the work rules, it's the addendum to the CBA, where there is productivity standards and employees can be disciplined for not meeting those standards.
And the union's agreeing to this because it's
yes.
It's
part of the work rules, yes.
It's part of the work rules. I know in our operation, we have the model coach, counsel, discipline. Coaching is, hey, maybe you forgot the rules here. Maybe you forgot the processes here. And then counseling is, geez, you know, we talked about the rules. We reminded you of it. We have to have an understanding here that you're not meeting the standards. And then it goes to discipline in that sense. And then depending on the infractions is what the discipline kicks in to do.
Right.
When we talk about the unfair labor practices, though, I'm reminded of there was a fellow named, his last name was Bulwar, and he was a negotiator for one of the big auto companies in the 50s. And he did such good homework and research that he'd go to the union at the time of the bargaining table, sit down and say, here's an offer, take it or leave it. And it was so good, the union took it. But after doing it a couple times, it was actually found to be an unfair labor practice because it wasn't bargaining in good faith.
Right.
That was, so when you mentioned that story about Bulwarism came to light. It was a very colorful fellow. So we've touched about that. And in the few moments we have left, and we are live tonight, 610-378-0426. Are there any other takeaways we can share with employees? What about employee notices? What kind of communication tools do you see work, and what kind do you see maybe don't work so well and maybe shouldn't keep trying to do?
We use a lot of visual material to communicate important messages to our employees repeatedly. We have television
screens. Paycheck stuffers?
Well, we have television screens in various places throughout the facilities, in both the manufacturing facility as well as the offices so that people can see ongoing news. We recognize employees for outstanding contributions. I mean, we're constantly communicating to our employees every day. And, you know, it takes the personal touch. Sometimes you need to go to a department meeting and actually be there with them and help them understand, especially if you're making changes to policies, procedures, or benefits. So we're always talking to our employees. It's very important to just have open communications.
Okay.
At my company, we're always looking to improve the communication resources.
Now, do you have a single plant, a single facility?
We do, and then we have salespeople on the road. So now with the office, it's easy, usually email. And our one group of union classification actually has their own emails as well. But I was finding out, even when I would shoot out an email blast, I was getting back, oh, I didn't see that. I didn't read that. Right. So we try to get everybody involved through postings, emails. If there's something we really need to communicate, we'll ask the supervisors to announce something or give us a brief presentation at their pre-shift meetings that all supervisors are required to have. But we're constantly trying to look for new ideas to get our communication out there.
So HR in these companies isn't really a piece of cake. Would you encourage people to get into HR today, knowing what you know now, or would you rather be doing something else?
It's never a dull day.
Never a dull day.
Never a dull day. And I enjoy it. I mean, personally, I enjoy it. I enjoy the interaction. So I enjoy the problem solving.
See, that's the thing. I think people out there maybe think that HR is this thing that just kind of happens organically. And it's real professionals out there every day trying to strike that balance, trying to keep that even keel, trying to keep the workforce engaged, trying to keep the company productive. And it's like you're a conductor that unfortunately has two arms, like, you better have like 8 or 9. Is that, especially with you have union and non-union workforces, it's different.
Yes. Right.
Okay. We have a few moments left, and I'd like to open it up just comments here. With labor relations strategy, obviously, when it happens, and you've got to go through an organizing campaign. There are rules for that. That's when really the unfair labor practice raises its head. What do you find with workforce tensions? They must have come up from time to time. How do you deal with them? Do you diffuse it? Investigations. How do you deal with workforce tensions? Do you see them at all in the union and non-union workforces? It's not like Hatfields and McCoys, but there have to be undercurrents in there sometimes. How do you recognize them? How do you see them? How do you avoid them? What do you do about that?
The workforce tensions that I've experienced in my career are generally due to change management. And because, you know, many of the companies I've worked with or consulted with, I've met long-term employees. I have a person on my team now who's worked with a company for 45 years. And so if you don't help them understand the reasons for change, then they become fearful or they resist the change. And so you really need to take the time to educate them about the reasons for the change and why, as a team, we need to move forward for the success and the sustainability of the company.
Mm-hmm. And I agree with that. I totally agree with that, with the change and just
Well, and especially now, do you
open.
See much, in the few minutes we have left, do you see much with the cross-generational? I mean, we've got people closer to retirement. We have people just coming out of high school and college. Do you see much difference there in union versus non-union or just even the generational issues?
Yes, the generational issues for the the 20-somethings that are coming into our company. Some of them have posed some very challenging negotiations for their offers that I find surprising. When I was their age, I probably wouldn't have thought to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas our more mature employees who are looking at retirement fairly soon are just happy to be able to continue to contribute and enjoy the years that they have left. So there's a huge difference in the workforce.
You finding that as well?
I'm actually seeing the opposite. Our more tenured union members are very nervous about taking things away, where our newer union members don't seem all that involved at this point. They seem very, stand back, I'm happy to have a job, and don't seem as involved as our more tenured union members.
Well, in the moment or two we have left, I'd like to take this time to certainly thank our esteemed and qualified panelists here, Jennie Rodriguez-Priest, Executive Director for Human Resources. Thank you for coming and being on first time.
Thank you.
We'll have you back, certainly. And Kathy Dale, also a Human Resource Manager, also a first time here, I believe.
Thank you.
So hopefully you'll come back and join us again. I'd like to thank our underwriter, Mosteller & Associates, a full-service professional human resource consulting firm. Their information will be on the screen in a moment. 610-779-3870 is their number. If you find yourself in HR needs that your internal people cannot meet. Certainly our chapter 179, an affiliate of the Society of Human Resource Management. And you can reach us at the www.berkspa.shrm, here it is on the screen, .org. Remember that this program is repeated Fridays at 8, Saturday at 1, and Wednesday at 9 a.m. We are also streaming bctv.org. You can catch our programs there, and I believe they might even put them on YouTube, but I'll have to verify that. And so with that, our next show is Tuesday, September 11th. That'll be our 81st program and approaching our 14th year. So again, thank you to the panel and to the people at BCTV, and especially John, Bobby behind the cameras, and Soleil and John in the engineering booth. Thank you and good night.
Human Resource Management on BCTV is supported by Mosteller & Associates.